The Cold War was entering its fifth warm phase when, in June 1982, the RAAF deployed a No. 10 Squadron P-3 Orion maritime surveillance aircraft to the Cocos Islands in the Indian Ocean. The objective of Operation Caterpillar, as it was dubbed, was to monitor a fleet of seven Soviet ships that had arrived in the area. Some 560 kilometers south of Cocos, the Orion took close-up photographs of a mysterious one-ton object floating on the water and monitored a Soviet recovery vessel as its crew retrieved the object. The photos, when released to the press, were hailed as an intelligence coup by the RAAF. The scrutiny proved justified. It was the first Western imagery to reveal what was evidently a small test model connected with the Soviet space shuttle program, an enormously expensive effort that would see fruition with the full-size shuttle's one and only orbital spaceflight 6 years later. Since 1981, when the first US space shuttle was launched, it was known that the Soviet Union was also developing a shuttle. It appeared, from the outside at least, to be a copy of the American design, but initial estimates suggested it might carry a payload twice that of the US shuttle. US intelligence had long been aware that the Soviets were experimenting with the space plane concept which NASA and the US Air Force had been developing. In 1965, work began on the vertical takeoff horizontal landing project, named Spiral, similar in concept to the USAF's rocket-launched X-20 Dinosaur Delta Wing lifting body, but optionally capable of air launching. Spiral closely resembled US lifting body prototypes. The project lapsed after a few years, but was revived in 1974 in response to the US Space Shuttle program, and a piloted test vehicle, the Mikoyan MiG-105, was flown from a runway in atmospheric test flights during 1976-78. The Spiral spaceplane, had it reached fruition, would have featured the innovative ability for the pilot to raise its wing dihedral angle to 60 degrees for atmospheric re-entry, creating a lifting body profile before lowering the wings and gliding to a landing. From 1969 to 88, the Spiral project accounted for several of the numerous launches of unpiloted orbital rocket plane, or BOR, small-scale re-entry test models. A scale model of a three-crew mini-shuttle was the first to fly, with three Cosmos series test flights launching the one-ton craft. While likely intended for shuttling crews and supplies to Salyut space stations, and perhaps as a replacement for the Soyuz T-3-man transporter spacecraft, it was the mini-shuttle's military potential that attracted more US government interest. Like the American X-20, such a craft could potentially be used as a quick-response reconnaissance or even a weapons platform. The Kremlin was made aware of preliminary US shuttle design data sometime after its program was announced in 1972. It was evident to many that the USSR should build a shuttle and launch system for its own space program. An important proponent was Leonid Smirnov, head of the well-funded Military Industrial Commission, VPK, which directed military projects and strategies for obtaining new technologies. In a secret meeting at the Kremlin in 1974, Smirnov briefed Soviet leader Leonid Brezhnev on priorities for the following year and raised the US shuttle program. It was in the VPK's interest to exaggerate any potential American threat, and Smirnov told Brezhnev that the Americans might use the shuttle as a space bomber capable of diving towards Moscow to deliver a nuclear weapon. Although that would have contravened the Outer Space Treaty signed by both parties in 1967, Brezhnev was easily persuaded. Despite opposition by the Soviet Minister of Defense to its necessarily large budget, in February 1976, a shuttle program, primarily military in focus, along with a space station program, were authorized by the Communist Party's Central Committee and the Soviet Council of Ministers. The shuttle program was named Buran, or Blizzard, and the space station Mir, meaning peace, world, or community, for which Buran, in its civil role, was to deliver components into Earth orbit for assembly. The space bomber threat was the subject of a report to the Kremlin the following month. It cited American plans to launch their shuttle into polar orbits from Vandenberg Air Force Base in California, potentially bringing it over Moscow. The Vandenberg site was needed partly to satisfy a NASA requirement formulated in 1973 and made public, that the shuttle be able to place a 11.4-ton payload into polar orbit to be retrieved on a subsequent mission. The specific weight requirement matched that of the secret Hexagon, or Big Bird military spy satellite, which could be accommodated in the US shuttle cargo bay. As events transpired, all hexagons were launched by Titan rocket, and Vandenberg was never used for shuttle launches, despite $4 billion being spent on facilities to do so. No American plans for the shuttle to carry weaponry are publicly known, but Soviet suspicion about the large payload requirement no doubt reinforced the urgency of its own program. In 1978, 2 years after program authorization, a group of seven cosmonauts began training for the Universal Rocket and Space Transportation System, or Space Shuttle System. With the Buran program underway, the Bohr test models came into their own. The fourth design, Bohr 4, was a half-scale model of the spiral lifting body incorporating a braking engine for atmospheric re-entry. The Cosmos 1374 mission launched the first Bohr 4 by Proton rocket from Kapustin Yar, east of Volgograd, on June 4, 1982, to test the heat tiles developed for the full-sized space shuttle. Its aim was to record the physical and chemical effects on the tiles of the hot plasma generated by atmospheric re-entry. Its orbital flight, re-entry and splashdown were followed by the RAAF, observed naval recovery operation described earlier. The following March, the recovery of a second Bohr 4 test vehicle was also photographed by a Cocos-based RAAF Orion. Based on the detailed photos obtained, NASA built a model for wind tunnel testing, which showed the design to be quite efficient and maneuverable. Six Bohr 5 craft launched during 1984-88 were 1/8 scale models of the Buran shuttle orbiter. Their re-entries were aimed to splash down in the Black Sea, away from prying Australian camera lenses. Certain Western aviation and aerospace technologies had long been acquired and adapted by the Soviet Union. Cases in point in the 1940s included the unlicensed reverse engineering of British jet aero engines and of America's Boeing B-29 bomber. In the 1960s, design documents from the Concorde and Boeing supersonic airliner projects were used in developing the Tupolev Tu-144. For the Buran program, the Committee for State Security, the KGB and the Chief Intelligence Directorate of the Soviet General Staff were tasked with acquiring all available American shuttle documentation. The first priority was the re-entry heat shielding, amounting to 124 documents. East-West research centers in Vienna and Helsinki were used as covers for transmitting the trawled information to Moscow. The US space shuttle data was actually unclassified and contained in databases available via NASA, government and commercial precursors to the internet. Shuttle research documents from Caltech, MIT and a host of other institutions were trawled. A US intelligence official described how Soviet embassy staff in Washington, D.C. would visit the government printing office with the document numbers they had obtained from the databases, covering wind tunnel tests, shuttle computer systems, solid rocket boosters, etc. They paid for the printing, collected the documents, and casually took them back to the embassy. The practice was eventually stopped. It was only after construction of the first Buran orbiter began in 1980, 4 years after program commencement, that the CIA realized just how much shuttle information had been obtained through overt Soviet trawling. It saved the government billions of rubles and years in research and development. By 1983, a full-sized shuttle orbiter had appeared in US spy satellite photos of the Raminskoye Flight Test Center near Moscow, and other details later became known. While externally similar to the American orbiter, though 90 centimeters shorter and with a slightly greater wingspan, Buran featured many differences. It weighed 6 ton less, as the main engines were contained within the Energia launch vehicle. The orbiter's rear rocket engines were only sufficient for post-launch orbital insertion. The weight advantage potentially allowed a slightly greater payload than its counterpart, not double as originally thought. Like the American shuttle, it was covered in thousands of ceramic thermal tiles for atmospheric re-entry, with critical areas made from reinforced carbon-carbon. Unlike its counterpart, Buran was capable of flying a fully automated mission with no crew. The American shuttle could land autonomously if need be, but never flew without a crew. Of the Soviet Defense Ministry's 4 stated primary goals for the shuttle, the first 3 were explicitly military. Potential payloads for Buran included anti-satellite and anti-missile weapons using lasers or rockets, and even targeting air, ground, and maritime objectives. Indeed, the man in charge of the Buran development program, Colonel General Alexander Maximov, was head of military space and missile programs. Only the fourth stated goal, the transportation of cosmonauts and supplies between a space station and Earth, was not explicitly military. In the 1960s, the N1 Super Heavy Lift launch vehicle was developed and planned to be used for the Soviet manned lunar program, but was cancelled in 1974 after several failures. A rocket of similar power was needed for the Buran program, and on May 13, 1987, its replacement was publicly announced. Under Mikhail Gorbachev's new glasnost or openness policy, Soviet radio announced the existence of the Energia launch vehicle, Buran's fuel tank with engines previously noted by US intelligence. It was, the announcer said, capable of launching a reusable spaceplane into low Earth orbit, the first public confirmation of the Buran program. Energia, like the orbiter, was to be fully recoverable after launch for reuse. At 60 meters, it stood taller than the US shuttle's external fuel tank and incorporated the four main engines fueled by liquid hydrogen with oxygen oxidizer. Four liquid-fueled boosters clustered around the central rocket, adding enough thrust for Energia to launch nearly a 100-ton payload, and potentially four more boosters could be added for launching up to 200-ton. The advantage of liquid-fueled rocket boosters over the US shuttle's solid rocket boosters was that thrust could be controlled. Just 2 days after the announcement, Energia first lifted off from the Roscosmos Cosmodrome at Baikonur in the remote Kazakhstan desert. For its maiden launch, it carried not Buran, but a mock-up of the Polyus spacecraft, a laser-shooting, or SCIF, satellite-killing response to the planned US Strategic Defense Initiative, known as Star Wars. Although Energia performed flawlessly, Polyus SCIF failed to orbit. 18 months later, on 15th of November 1988, Energia's second launch took Buran Orbiter 1.01 into orbit for the first and only time. It was unmanned and fully automated, a world first for a full-size spaceplane. After separation from Energia, the orbiter fired its rear engines to maneuver into orbit. It completed two orbits before re-entering the atmosphere, when an onboard computer decided to change the landing direction due to a 60 km/h crosswind. Buran successfully landed itself on the runway near Baikonur. Elapsed time was 206 minutes since launch, a remarkable technical achievement. The USSR was dissolved in 1991, and within a couple of years, the Buran program was indefinitely suspended. Plans for three more unmanned Buran space flights, which were to include atmospheric and radiation experiments, along with manned flights, were scrubbed. With the existing Soyuz system evidently fulfilling the role adequately, and with much criticism that the expense of Buran was sapping funds from other space programs, it was no longer considered viable or necessary. The US shuttle program, meanwhile, continued until 2011 to complete the International Space Station project. Had the Buran program continued, the second orbiter was to be launched 3 years after the first, in 1991. Manned flights would have commenced in 1994. It was intended that the shuttles would initially service the Mir space station, but as events transpired, the only shuttles to dock with Mir were American during 1995 to 97, conveniently using docking ports designed for the Buran shuttle. Orbiter 1.01, mounted on its AN-225 carrier aircraft, was displayed at the 1989 Paris Air Show. In a final ignominy, the historic orbiter and its Energia launch vehicle were destroyed on May 12, 2002, when the roof of their hangar at Baikonur collapsed, killing 8 people. In effect, Buran was a second-generation shuttle system, benefiting from and potentially improving upon the American designs and methods. In some respects, it would have been more capable. It could perform spaceflight uncrewed and was designed to stay in orbit for 30 days, twice the American shuttle's duration. It could deliver an equal 30-ton payload into orbit. It was originally designed for a crew of up to 10 cosmonauts, 3 more than the American, although it would have generally carried just 4, each of whom had an ejection seat for emergencies, a capability that might have saved the American Challenger crew. Russian sources state that 39 principally new materials and 230 new technologies were developed specifically for the program. However, like the USA, the USSR decided space shuttles were not an efficient means of launching payloads into space. That might not have been a major impediment if its missions were to be primarily military. But with a cost over its 16-year program of some 16 billion rubles, about 100 billion Australian dollars in today's money, Buran was the most expensive of all Soviet space programs. Up to 1,200 organizations and perhaps 1 million workers were involved. Its payloads would thus have cost up to 6 times more to launch than by Soyuz rocket. The Energia launch vehicle, on the other hand, was more flexible than the US shuttle system, as it could carry other payloads of up to 100 ton. In the political and economic environment that developed in the USSR, soon after Buran's launch though, the program's future effectiveness could not be tested.